I'm Tammy Kolda, an applied mathematician, and this is Unlocking LaTeX Graphics. Today's episode is based on a user request to show how to draw complex diagrams with elements that need to be aligned and connected in various ways. I'm going to try to reproduce a diagram with various bits of box text, auxiliary text, colored regions, and so on. In the process of doing so, I'll demonstrate various techniques available in TikZ for aligning graphics. I covered many of these details in a prior video that I'll link in the show notes, so I encourage you to also watch that. These videos are based on my book, Unlocking LaTeX Graphics, as well as some bonus materials. Let's get started with our document preamble and posting the image that we want to recreate. I'm using the geometry package to create a convenient paper size for our demonstration. I'm using the hyperref package to link the author name of this document to the YouTube channel, and also to include a link to the source of this image. I'm using GraphicX to display the image we're reproducing. The key package here is TikZ. Today, we'll also make use of a bunch of different TikZ libraries, positioning, backgrounds, calc, and arrows.meta. I'll link to episodes that explain these in the show notes. I also went ahead and got things set up in the document itself. I have a placeholder for our TikZ figure, and it will be filled in. Below that, I have the figure that we're trying to reproduce from the website vcyang.com. So shout out to them for this lovely graphic. I'm showing it here, and then we'll try to reproduce that and see if we can emulate what they've created. There's many ways we could recreate this image. I'm going to do it by focusing on drawing the text boxes first and then filling in around that. To do that, I'll create some TikZ styles that can make things easier. So I'm going to use one style for all those box nodes, but I also observe that they're kind of grouped into three columns and each column has its own width. So I'm also going to define styles for each column called call 1, 2, and 3. Let me paste that in our code. I'm pasting it inside the figure environment because I only need it there. If I wanted this to be available more broadly, I could do it outside the figure environment. The text box style draws a thick outline with rounded corners. The default for rounded corners is 4-point. Here I'm changing it to 6-point. We also align the text in the center and set the font as sans serif and large. I'm also setting the inner X separation to 0, and I'm going to actually control the width of the nodes with the text width command I'm going to specify for each of the columns. So here I have column 1. I'm setting the text width and the minimum height as I think is appropriate for that one. I do the same for columns 2 and 3. I arrived at these text widths and heights through some trial and error trying to get it to look a lot like the original figure. Now let's go ahead and add our figure. I'm going to paste a bit of code here to draw the first column of boxes. Each one of these nodes has a text box and call 1 styles, and I give each node a name. In the first node, I use a hard break before the last line, and then I scooch it up a little bit by -1 millimeter, and then I set that bottom text to be script size to make it a bit smaller. I had many options for how to place these nodes. I could, for example, use explicit coordinates and lay them out on a grid. I'm actually using the positioning library and placing them one below the other. So this box that has implications in it is 15 millimeters below the real world problems box. And then the text node with data is 9 millimeters below the implications node. Now let's go ahead and fill in column 2. If I look at this original image, I observe that these top two nodes are aligned at the top. There's no easy command in the positioning library that I know of to do that, but really the positioning library is just shortcuts for using anchors and shifts. And we can use those more directly to get the flexibility we need to get those top two nodes aligned. So let me go ahead and paste the code for the second column. This topmost node is positioned as follows. I'm setting its anchor to be the northwest corner. I'm saying it should be positioned at the northeast corner of this node over here, but then I'm shifting it over by 23 millimeters to get it where it has landed. And then the second node, I just position 15 millimeters below the first. If I look at the original diagram, The single node over here on the right is midway between the two nodes in the second column. I could get at that midpoint a few different ways, but I'm going to go ahead and draw a path from the southeast corner of the top node to the northeast corner of the bottom node, and then place my text box midway along that and to the right. So when I compile that, then we get our governing equations node over here. I position these nodes using different shifts to the bottom and to the right and so on. You might be wondering how I decided what those lengths should be. Well, there's a trick you can use, and it's what I use to figure out how to place things. You can draw the image that you're working with underneath of what you're drawing and then use that for alignment. I'm going to paste a segment of code here, compile it, and then show you what I'm talking about. So I'm drawing something onto the background layer. I'm using a scope and then on background layer as one of the options. I'm also shifting the picture. If I didn't shift it, it would just kind of be off and unaligned. So I'm shifting it over by trial and error again, 4.3 in the X value and minus 1.3 in the Y value to get it so that it's aligned with that first node, the real world problem. And then I draw a semi-white transparent box over top of the image, make it faded. It just makes it a little bit easier to work with. Otherwise, it's hard to tell what I've drawn versus what's in the original image. And then I was able to use that to sort of decide like exactly how far apart to make things. So I'm actually not going to keep that here because it's a little bit distracting from what we're trying to do, but that's a trick that you can use whenever you want to recreate a drawing. So recompile that. Next, I want to add the arrows and the annotations on the arrows that we see here. I'll define two more styles. The connector style is going to be used for the arrows themselves. We use rounded corners, and we're going to make it an 8-point rounding, and that's for the arrows that are bent. Then we're going to make the line width thicker even than ultra thick. So I'm going to actually specify the line width to be 3 PT. And we're going to shorten the arrows at the beginning and the end so they don't quite touch the points where they start and stop. So I'm doing that by a distance of 2.5 millimeters at each end. I'm also using the triangle arrow type, but I'm modifying its width and its length. You can do this by putting square brackets in front of the name, adding your options, but making sure to enclose the entire thing in curly braces. And that's because you have this comma in the middle here and it'll get confused otherwise. I'm also defining an annotate style for the bits of text that decorate the arrows in a few places. We're going to make it a sans serif font. We're going to align the text to the left of the node, and we're going to put the node midway. And then we're just tighten up the inner X separation a bit. The first arrow is an interesting one. It's not at the top or the center, but it's really like a little bit down from the upper corners. Let me paste the code that we need here. So we're going to draw our connector object. We're going to tell it which way the arrow goes. We're going to start at this northeast corner of this node, but before we draw our arrow, we're going to go down by 4 millimeters. Using what's called a move to operation. So I'm not drawing it because I didn't put a dash dash in between those. I'm just moving. And then I'm going to go ahead and create a coordinate named A. And then I'm going to draw a line from that point over to the corresponding point on the right. The way I'm setting that up is I'm getting the X value from the westernmost point of this node and the Y value from that coordinate A that I just declared. I'm also going to define a coordinate named mid halfway through this line. Let me go ahead and compile that and you can see the result. So there we have our arrow. It can be really easy to lose track of coordinates. I just declared two coordinates, A and then also mid. I forgot to mention that mid is what we're going to use to divide the picture later between the salmon colored part and the olive colored part. One trick I use sometimes is to temporarily draw the coordinates so that I can see where they are. So let me paste a bit of code here and show you what I mean. Here I'm using a for each loop, and I list the nodes I want to draw. And all I'm going to do is create a node at each of those coordinates. In very tiny text, I'm scaling it to size 0.5. I'm going to just put a little node to show where my nodes are. So here's the node A, and here's the node mid. I'm going to remove this for the final picture, but it's a way that I use to remember where all my coordinates are. Note, I also use this overlay option when I defined those nodes. This means that it won't shift the picture in any way when I'm adding these extra nodes. That says draw it on top, but don't change the bounding box. Now let's add the remainder of the connectors and the annotations. Let me paste the code and then I'll walk us through it. So the first arrow I'll talk about is the curved arrow from the governing equations to the solution to model behavior. I'm starting off at the southern point of this one, and then I'm coming over and I'm coming to the southeast corner, but shifted up 4 millimeters just to kind of mirror what's happening up here. I'm also drawing an annotated node over to the right, and I'm shifting the X and Y values a little bit to get it where I want it to be. The arrow from solution to model behavior, I'm aligning that with the center of the implications mode. But if I start at the center of the left side of this node, it wouldn't line up right. So I'm pulling out the X value from this westmost point, but I'm getting the Y value from the point I'm connecting to, the easternmost point of this implications node. The arrow from implications to real world problems, those nodes are already center aligned, so I don't have to do anything too fancy there. And I'm just adding a node to the right that says inform. And then finally, I have another arrow from data to this middle lower node. I'm actually kind of drawing that in reverse because I want to start a little off center from this node. And so what I'm doing is I'm taking the southmost point, but then I'm doing a move to operation to shift over slightly to the left by 4 millimeters. Then I'm starting to draw my point and I have it make a right turn and go to data.east. I need to draw the arrow the opposite way. So that's why I have the arrowhead at the beginning rather than the end of the connector. And then I have my node annotation. I've shifted it with the X and Y, and I'm also making it above left of that point. Next, I've been trying to get the subtitles we see over here, real world and math world. To do that, let me first define a subtitle style. This makes the anchor at the base of the node, the inner Y separation is a little bit bigger than normal. And then I'm setting the font to be the sans serif family, boldface, and large. Now let's scroll down and add our subtitles. So I go down here to the bottom of the picture, and then I'm going to paste in the two titles. The real world is just centered above real world problem, so that's easy. The other node is a little funnier. We want it to be sort of midway between this midpoint and then the rightmost side of this diagram, and then aligned with the node over here. So I'm going to use this complicated let and in expression where we can define inline variables. I'm going to first create a point called P1, which is going to be the coordinate that is at the halfway point between mid and the easternmost part of this, taking the X value from that and the Y value again from mid, and then taking the halfway point. So this is using the calc library. And then my second point is just going to be the base of real world. And then I'm going to use the X value from the first point and the Y value from the second point in this formula, and then put my math world at that point. There's a lot of different ways you could do that. I probably did it the most complicated way, so you can maybe experiment and see how you'd like to do it, but that's how I'm getting that node there. We have this fancy arrow down here that says start here. I'm going to draw an arrow, but I'm not going to make it nearly as fancy as that. I'm sure it's possible, but I'm going to keep this part at least relatively simple. So first I'll put in a style for this start here node that we're going to draw. I'm just going to draw it midway on the arrow above a light center and make it footnote size. And that's not quite small enough, so I'm going to scale it by 0.8 and then do a little bit of shifting and so on. Let me go down and actually paste the drawing of the arrow and the node itself. We're going to start the arrow at this point that's over 1.4 at an angle of 180 degrees, so straight out to the left. I'm going to call that coordinate B. And then I'm going to draw from that coordinate B back over to this northwest point. So let me compile that and you can see the result. And I've just put start here above that in small text. Remember where that node B is, I can add it to those drawings of the nodes that I've been doing. And then I'll get a little node that sort of says where my coordinate B is. At long last, we're ready to draw these two boxes, the salmon colored and the olive colored box in the background. I'm going to go ahead and start by putting down some colors. I'm redefining red here to start to be a little closer to the start here red that was used in the diagram that we're emulating. I'm redefining the color inside the fig environment so it's not hurting anything. I'm also defining my own olive and my own salmon. And I did these by using a color picker utility, which is available in the Power Tools library on Windows. There's many other tools available online. And I just pulled out the HTML colors of that and used the define color part of XColor to define my custom colors. Recall that that mid coordinate is going to be what's going to determine the horizontal split between the two boxes. Now I'm going to define coordinates for the bottom, right, top, and left that I'll also use to help draw my boxes. So here are those bunch of coordinates. I'm using the current bounding box to define these. So it does matter when I declare these coordinates because the bounding box will continue to evolve as I add more components. And if I did it earlier, it wouldn't be as big as it is now. But it does matter where you call that. And there's probably other ways you could do it. I'm also shifting everything around a bit. And then again, to see where I just put those nodes, since it might not be obvious, I can go ahead and add them to the list of coordinates that I'm going to draw a little symbol of just so I know where they are. Finally, I can use all this to draw the boxes. So here I'm drawing it on the background layer. So I don't want to draw over top of what I just did. I'm going to fill this left rectangle with salmon. And so I start at the left and top corner, taking the X value from left and the Y value from top. And then I draw a rectangle down to the mid X value and bottom Y value. I do a similar thing with the olive. And then I also draw this thick dashed line right at this midpoint, starting at the top and going to the bottom. The last step is adding the title. Let me go ahead and do that. It's only a single node, so I will avoid scrolling up and down to create a special style for that. Let me paste our final node here. We're going to do it at the start at the left top and be above right of that. We're going to make it a huge font that is like a little bit too big, so I'm scaling it to 98% of huge. And then I have typical mathematical modeling process. So we're almost done. The last thing we'll do is go ahead and hide the coordinates that we were giving little labels to. And now when I recompile it, I think we have something that looks pretty close to the original picture we were trying to draw. I think we ended up with a pretty good recreation of the original picture. I hope you enjoyed today's episode where we showed many of the tools available for aligning objects in a complex image. I link to the overleaf document I created today in the show notes. If you found this helpful or interesting, please click like or subscribe. If you have TIXI or PGF plots questions, please post them in the comments. If you want to learn more, please check out the other videos. I also have a book, Unlocking LaTeX Graphics, available for purchase at major book retailers. Thanks for watching.